Alrighty, Jake, we're back again. It's been a long time.
Has been a long time.
Yes. But before we get into any of the interesting stuff, I have a very important question for you. Why does Santa Claus have such a big sack?
I don't know.
He only comes once a year.
Oh my god. I forgot that you do these. I completely forgot.
Now you remember?
Now I remember. You're really starting this one off with a bang.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Thanks.
Patreon, Twitter, Discord, Letterboxd. It's all in the description. I'm not going to waste any more time with that. But it's all in the description. All the stuff's there. It's all there for you guys. So, wow. So it's been about 6 or 7 months since we've done one of these.
Yeah, we're in very different situations, very different...
It was interesting because the last time we did videos like this, I think when Adam was there, we talked about... It was the end of 2019 and we were talking about, like, we were predicting 2020 and how it was going to go downhill.
Yeah, what did we say? Did we say it was going to go downhill?
Yeah, we did. And we were...
Oh, man.
We were
fucking bang on, weren't we?
Yeah, we were absolutely right.
Yeah.
New Zealand's in lockdown for the second time.
And
we've decided that going forward, it'll be a more productive way to make these videos is over OBS and Discord, just the same way I do with Callum on Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
And we're thinking we might come together for the season recaps, as those are sort of, you need to have a group discussion over those. Depending on where the world's at the time, we have no fucking idea.
Yeah.
But, we had a little chat about these reviews, and we think that we're going to try it again on this platform and see how it goes and see if it works better. We're also planning to have a little bit of a shake-up of the format. We'll see how it goes. There's some things that will stay, some things that might not. We're just trying to sort of re-establish what we're going to be doing with these videos and find ways to make it more enjoyable and more doable, more accessible, all those things. But still hit the main points of these videos that all of you like to see and all of we like to do. That's the main thing that's changing.
That is the plan.
Yes. But regardless, it's great to finally do these again. We've been doing this series for like 2.5 years now. It's insane.
Yeah. It was a little old thought. That I think, I don't know if it was you or I that had the idea.
It was you.
I think I did, didn't I? And then, kind of really manifested itself and turned into something bigger, which is pretty cool.
Mm.
Yeah. We've actually, I don't know if the viewers know, but we've actually done a Discord talk before on this channel, but it was for Game of Thrones.
That was actually Skype, to be fair.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, it was Skype. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Mm.
Well. But, why were we using Skype? God, this is a garbage program.
Yeah, it is. It was before the Discord OBS days. We're much better now. But yes, we are back with more Doctor Who. So, last time was the Series 2 finale, and you had the recap as well. You had Doomsday with the Daleks and the Cybermen and Rose's exit. And then at the very end of that episode appeared... A woman in a wedding dress.
Yep.
So now we go into the 2006 Christmas special, The Runaway Bride.
Ooh.
So, okay. Your thoughts going into this episode?
Well, I don't know. It's been a while since I've even thought about Doctor Who, so I think it's going to be kind of interesting to go into this. With trying to remember a little bit about what I've watched before, and then two, just some new things, some new people, obviously Rose is gone, maybe we don't actually know, but for now we think she is.
She's in a parallel universe, so yes, she's gone.
Well. Maybe. You never know with Doctor Who. I'm kind of looking forward to just kind of enjoying this episode and seeing what happens and thinking critically about some TV shows again, because it's been a while since I've watched something to think critically about it instead of just watching it. So
I sort of with these reviews that we've been doing, it's sort of a bit of a half-half for me. It's a bit, there's a critical aspect of it, but then there's also enjoying it as well. It's a bit of both, really.
I guess the cool thing is, in a way, I've kind of taken a break from Doctor Who as if it were the season ending and then a new season starting, right? Like it's like the off season for everyone else that they would have had.
Yeah, well, I mean, the break between the two episodes that you just saw and about to see was from like July to December, and so for here it's like December to August, so it's almost like it's similar kind of break that people would have had.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting, I suppose.
Yeah.
But yeah, anything else you want to say before we get into The Runaway Bride?
No, I think we should get into it.
All right then, let's begin The Runaway Bride. So I'll do a countdown for us to hit the play button.
Mm-hmm.
And also, if you're not aware, because we're doing it on this format and there's no risk of copyright, we're going to be doing full-length reactions that are Patreon exclusive now. So when I hit the play button, everyone else on the full-length reaction can also hit the play button and watch the episode along with us without any of the edits. They can just watch the whole thing, get a full reaction.
Nice.
So that's something new.
Play along with us.
Yes.
Play along.
Yes, get the full experience. All right, are you ready, Jake?
I am. Ah, love a bit of BBC. Oh, laters.
So we got the other point of view.
Yeah. Oh, sit back and relax. Catherine Tate. It's a new name to the
Oh, the surfboard's on fire now.
Oh wow.
We got a new surfboard.
Oh, Russell T. Davies, we're in for a treat. On you, Donna. Yeah. Well, you bloody open them. What was that for? Get me to the church! the solar system. We can hurry up and lose me! God damn. It's an anti-vaxxer.
He's not a bit of a way with the zip runners for it, is he? Fucking Slovene. I'm in my wedding dress. Give me pockets! I'm not from Mars. He's a bit useless when the TARDIS is broken.
Yeah.
No. I'm
pockets!
Who gets married on Christmas Eve?
Donna Noble, apparently. An actual phone box.
It's like he's waiting in line to go to the toilet.
He's not very good at waiting.
Yeah.
Hey, that's cheeky. That's burglary.
Wouldn't mind one of those. Oh.
Ah, they're back. The Santas.
Oh boy.
What a distraction. Free money.
Thinking on his toes. Now, why would your taxi driver be dressed up as Santa?
Because it's clear. Because it's the 24th of December.
Yeah, but. Oh, come on, mate. He's playing whack-a-mole with the TARDIS. Oh boy.
Ha ha ha. She's not very good at being rescued.
Oh. Yeah.
It's one of those ones that the parents wouldn't believe.
Yeah.
Wish you had a time machine. Then we could go back and get it right. God, you're skinny. This won't fit a rat.
With this ring. A bio. Oh. The doc's coming to steal your man. Mate, woman. Well, man.
You're not connected, you're not clever, you're not important. This friend of yours just before she left, did she punch you in the face? Stop bleeping me! That was it.
When was it?
6 months ago.
Six months ago?
Well, he insisted.
You're bargain.
Oh, this is cruel.
You had the reception without me. Still paid for, why not? Thank you, Neris.
Oh.
What the fuck?
It always works. Oh, a flip phone.
Yeah. God, Googling something on a flip phone? Oh, he's downloading the internet.
Ah, Torchwood.
Ah.
I love Welsh people. Maybe he's a descendant of Mr. Sneed.
Oh boy. Oh no.
Oh no, not another tree.
Oh no. Look at that mohawk. Whoa!
Oh no, not the cake! This has been a really action-heavy episode, actually.
Yeah. Ah, oh, this is bad. Ow, this is hurting my ears. Let's turn that down.
Anti-ASMR.
Yeah.
Clever boy.
Oh, what the fuck?
It's a big web.
Oh. It's a big web and a starfish.
I was in Spain. Good driving. I'm a pencil inside a mug.
Yes, you are. 4H sums you up. Lance, what was that?
We know who wears the pants. They just don't have pockets. The bride. The golden rule is Christmas villains, they gotta be hammy.
Gotta be hammy.
Yep, we had the Sycorax last time, and now we've got whatever this is. Fucking segue. So slow. Ah. Don't slip.
Isn't it a major London landmark?
Oh, I know. Unheard of.
Oh, jeez. He's hit the cocaine. This feels like a video game, like the way the plot's unfolding.
Yeah,
I like it.
Lance is dipped. Oh,
Ragnos.
Oh no. God, she's thick. Oh. That's got a different meaning now.
Oof. That's just sad. It's personnel.
Oh man. Made it easy. Oh man. Just want to point out the obvious. They won't hit the bride. They're such very good. So do you know what you said before about a time machine? Well, I lied. And now we're gonna use it. It's the wedding in perspective.
Oh, backseat driver. Oh, it's the extrapolator. Fucking Slitheen wanted to use it as a surfboard. Get fucked, humans. That's one way to reproduce.
Yeah. When a spider has morals. Oh no.
It just looks like a cool presentation.
Yeah. Oh.
Prepare for chaos, children.
It's really loud again.
Run for your fucking lives.
Run or you get zapped. George, the jungle.
More like Spider-Man.
They're bigger on the inside. It's like Harry Potter.
It's like the TARDIS.
Oh, true.
TARDIS pockets. This is like proper Thunderbirds, like, direction.
Yeah.
Oh no! All the children! I'd hate to climb a wet ladder.
Yeah. And heels. As well.
Oh.
Mad lady. Oh boy. Well, shouldn't have made your spaceship out of toilet paper.
His boat's on land. That's a party trick. Well, you
coolest. Oh. Come with me. Oh. Doctor. Oh. Find someone.
I should do. Because sometimes I think you need someone to stop me. A friend of yours. What was her name?
Her name's Rose.
All right, pause it before the surfboard. Don't get spoiled. Yeah. All right.
I paused it. It says Octo. And this is Octo on my screen.
All right, Jake, your initial thoughts on The Runaway Bride?
I thought it was pretty enjoyable. I thought it was a very well-balanced episode between action and story and new, you know, a little bit of lore there as well included. I thought it was pretty good. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I the first word I'd use is fun. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was fun.
Obviously, you know, at the time, Catherine Tate was peaking in terms of her popularity as a British comedian on TV. Right. So this was during, like, the pinnacle of when she was doing her show. And obviously this was, like, her being on the show was a big get for them.
Mm-hmm.
I thought she was... Like just overall, the bringing her in to play Donna was such a breath of fresh air.
Mm.
This episode to me, watching it, it felt very different. Not like it still felt the same show, but there was something different about this episode that felt like it wasn't like the episodes you've seen before. If you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I would say this to me felt more like a sort of like Christmas film than an episode of TV. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean,
it wasn't. It wasn't quite.
It was
long
very
enough.
Contained.
It wasn't quite.
It was very contained.
Yeah,
is I think the best way, like a good way to put it, is like it was. It had the complete structure of a story by itself, and I think it was just really well written. I think it was really well thought out. Not like the most complex story in the world.
Oh yeah.
But still a very well-done story, so...
Well, yeah, I mean, this this one, like, probably had the most sonic screwdriver we've ever seen. There was a lot of shortcuts in terms of the plot, but in terms of the characters and the fun of it, I really, really enjoy it.
Yeah.
I think it's the kind of episode that you would want as a Christmas special, if you get what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It might be a little bit of a different scenario if it was part of the main series.
But it wasn't also, like, the thing that I liked about it is... It wasn't about Christmas, really.
Yeah.
Like, it was just set at Christmas. It was just set in Christmas time.
Just like the Christmas Invasion wasn't about Christmas either.
Yeah. Because as we know on this channel that I don't like Christmas, so...
Neither does Donna, apparently.
Yeah.
But yeah, so now, this is interesting to me. So, let's talk about the Doctor. And I suppose we could say Donna as well, because she spent most of her screen time with him. So...
Yeah.
For me, the main takeaway I have from this, I mean, there was a lot of fun stuff, like a lot of fun stuff, right?
Yep.
All the jokes, all the great humor and all that stuff, like this thing about pockets and all that crap. That was great. I love that.
Yeah.
But the main takeaway for me from this is very much a follow up to Doomsday.
Yeah.
Because
you can still, obviously you had that scene of him having the flashbacks with Rose. Mm. So there's still like that.
It's still rawness to it. Yeah, it's still a tender spot. And the most talked about element of this episode in regards to the Doctor is in the climax when he drowns all the spider children. And he doesn't stop himself until Donna says, "You can stop now," because she can see it's like unnecessary, like how far he's going with it.
Yeah.
Because you can tell he's in such a sort of trance of anger and emotion that he's not really holding himself back. And that was brought up again in the very last scene where she says, you know, "I think you need to find someone because you need someone to stop you."
Yeah.
And I think it sort of shows that, like, coming off losing Rose, he's becoming a bit unhinged.
Yeah. Well, I think he's lost focus, you know, and maybe a bit of that human compassion and empathy is a bit lost.
And that makes sense. Well. That makes sense to me, because if you remember, Rose was the person who pulled him out of, you know, post-Time War grief.
Yeah.
So now he's sort of lost that, you know, that element.
He's lost the grounding.
Mm.
That, yeah.
And I think Donna could see that in him. But that's what, something I really liked about it, is how that, even though Donna's a bit daft, you know, she missed all the fucking important alien invasions because she was had a hangover or she was scuba diving in Spain or something. That was hilarious. But the fact that she has that human heart, that she can see that the Doctor has flaws.
Yeah.
I think that's probably the strongest element of the writing for me.
Yeah. I think so too. The main thing is that it still makes the Doctor not seem human, which is important, because he's been obviously played by a human person. So, yep. But you need that distinction that he's not a human. He doesn't have human emotions. He needs, he can feel human emotions, but he doesn't innately feel them for every situation, which makes sense. As why Donna would say something like that.
Mm. Also, another thing I want to note about the Doctor is David Tennant's performance. And the one thing that I would say about him is that he feels like he's aged a little bit.
Mm.
If you get what I'm saying, like he's in a lot of series too, he's very much, he has this like teenage persona.
Mm.
Like it's almost high schoolish at points, especially when Rose and Mickey are both there. And that's great. That was fun. But this to me felt like he was older.
Do you think
than that.
Also, I think partly as well, it was like, cause he had Donna as the companion.
Mm.
This episode was like, she's older and obviously has not as much of a, you know, open mind to.
Yeah.
Action and scary things happening. She's more closed off and wants to just be in her bed at home.
I also think there's another element to that. I think when he was around Rose, he was playing it up a bit.
Yeah.
But now that she's gone, we're sort of seeing what he's actually like.
Yeah.
And that to me is great because it adds another layer to the character.
Yeah.
And I feel way more depth with the Doctor now than I would say this is the most depth we've had with the Doctor since Eccleston.
Yeah, I think it's really progressing. The arc of, like, so we're really getting back to the Doctor's character arc.
Well, this was the first time in New Who that they mentioned Gallifrey by name, so we're I think I accidentally mentioned it to you before. Not thinking about it, but this is the first time that they've said the word Gallifrey as the Doctor's home planet.
Yeah.
I
already knew that.
Yeah, and it's really it's digging into the character now. There was hints of it throughout series two. There were hints of it. Like, I would say one of the episodes that really sort of started to dig deep was in the Impossible Planet Satan Pit, when he was abseiling down into the cave, and it was that whole scene where, you know, it was really. It was more so going into his sort of morals and his like beliefs and stuff, and that was all like adding layers into the character as well. But here, it's a lot more like personal stakes, and it's more development.
Yeah,
which is you're probably going to get that more so in showrunner episodes than guest writer episodes. But yeah, I thought that to me, this episode really adds layers to the 10th Doctor that we haven't really seen. And it's a really nice progression from what we got in the finale of Series 2, I would say.
I agree. Yeah.
I also think David Tennant and Catherine Tate have very good chemistry on screen.
Yeah, they do. I can almost guarantee a lot of that would have been ad-libbed. And, like, obviously going partially off the script, but I feel like a lot of that was definitely both of them bouncing off each other. Because... Mm. Has David Tennant done comedy?
He might have.
I feel like he has for some reason.
I can't recall. I haven't seen it if he has, but he may.
He's
have.
A pretty comedic dude anyway.
Oh,
when it comes to acting. So yeah, I think I definitely, that their chemistry work very, very well together.
Also, I would say part of the comedy is that, but it's also to do with the writing as well, because this episode had a lot of the... We were talking in the review of Love and Monsters about the quick cuts and how it would that Russell T. Davies would execute humor using cutting between scenes. And this episode had quite a bit of that too. It had a few cuts in it and like flashbacks as well.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really well handled. I thought a lot of the comedy.
I don't think it was overly funny though. I think it.
Oh yeah, no.
It hit that right note, which is good.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't say it was barnstormingly hilarious, but it was pretty funny. Like, especially, I think probably the funniest bit for me is when they had the reception without her, which is really funny at first, but then it's really sad after. That's something that I think is the most interesting for me about Donna's character, is how she's quite funny, but there's a tragedy to that. It's quite sad that how, you know, how life's treated her like shit. And
she's kind of like, she's the laughing stock of of everyone.
And I think the moment where, like, it was definitely, like, invoking humor, but it was just so tragic that it was quite sad, was when Lance betrayed her.
Yeah.
Like, that actually, that
but his whole spiel was funny as well. Yeah. And just, like, can't even point to Germany on a map.
Yeah, and that's funny, but like, again, like the context of it, the fact that she's been just ruined by him for the last, she's wasted 6 months of her life planning a wedding. Yeah. You can see why she was
just to be poisoned, to be used.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, horrible feeling, you know?
Yeah.
But
still kind of funny though.
I also think that it's one of the things that 10th Doctor had, you've seen from him so far, is that he has an ego.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Donna is like the perfect foil to that ego, because she kind of humbles him down a bit. And one of the biggest scenes of that is when, you know, he's saying, oh, you could come travel with me, and she rejects him.
Yeah.
And I think that's why they have such a good rapport, is because of how she.
I think because she's a strong voice. Like I definitely like Catherine Tate's acting. Like, she's got a very strong demeanor to the way she speaks and the way she like commands her role. So it's like too, like, if we were to put Donna on the cocaine meter, right?
Mm.
Like, she would be the step below Scarface at some points in there.
Yeah, true.
Because
they have that similarity of energy, but I think one big difference between her and someone like Rose, because Rose was head over heels for him.
Yeah.
And that's and that fed his ego. That increased his, you know, arrogance. Yeah. But then you get someone like Donna who brings him down in a understandable way, and it's like, you can see how it neutralizes him, and that's, oh, she's just the exact right character for this point in time for him.
Mm.
To sort of expose those flaws, and I love it.
Mm-hmm.
Those two characters for me are the highlight of this story, like the whole thing. 100%. They were excellent. Shall we move on to something else?
Yeah.
The only other sort of major characters we got were the Empress of the Rachnos and Lance.
Yeah. There was definitely a bit of lore behind the Empress, and which was cool. But
yeah, the whole thing about Time Lords killed them.
Yeah, and then them being the center of the Earth.
And also like her motivation as well, like, it's all for survival, so you can see why she's doing it. It's understandable.
Yeah. But still, I feel like the main purpose of that character was to be funny still. It was still a funny villain. I mean, if you were a kid, that would be a terrifying villain. Mm. But
she's very very hammy.
Yeah, watching that now, like, it's just hilarious. They were just so over the top.
Mm. But that's, and I thought it was like,
great.
Yeah, I know. I feel like that's very tongue in cheek though, a bit like the Sycorax.
100%.
You know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, is like, just like the Sycorax, it's like, it's like something that would be scary to someone that hasn't experienced a lot of things that are actually scary, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's got a double edge to it, in the sense it's scary for a child but hilarious for an adult, and it creates that like family entertainment value, if you know what I mean.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, you can laugh at your kids being scared of something that's funny.
Yeah, I know. And I just I don't know what it is, but there's just something about that style that I really enjoy. It's I have the same thing with the Sicker Axe. I had the same thing with the Slitheen, and I have the same thing with John Lumick from the Sideman story. It's just there's something about a hammy performance that can really just it could just really hit the right spot for me. It's and also the Krillitane from School Reunion as well. Like Anthony Head's performance, and that was quite hammy, though it was a bit more subtle.
Yeah.
But he's like, Doctor, you could rule the universe. We could bring your planet back. This isn't your classroom, Kenny. That sort of thing. Yeah, I don't know. I loved it. I also loved the prosthetics, like the practical effects on the Ratnos looked cool.
Yeah. Yeah, they were really good. Yeah, I mean, I guess with Lance, like, he had that one good performance, and it was pretty funny in all respects. But I don't know, that he was more just a catalyst to the plot.
It was definitely a two dimensional character. He didn't have much depth to him. But he just
served a purpose to progress the other characters.
I thought he worked well because firstly he worked really well in the comedic flashback scenes. I really liked him there. He got that down, and then I also found when he turned and essentially revealed who he was. Like it was quite cackling, but the way he said those insults to Donna actually kind of hurt. Like to watch.
They were bitter. They were
And I was convinced.
Said with some stab.
I was convinced by the performance that this guy.
So was I.
Yeah.
I thought he did a great performance. Yeah.
Yeah.
And also just when he's dancing with that chick, I can't remember what her name was at the reception.
Oh yeah.
And when Donna comes back and he just turns around, and he's like, "Oh, what?"
Yeah, Donna's like bitchy friend. You know, that's the whole idea. And then there's a few other minor characters, like you got Donna's mum and dad, who were there too. Unfortunately, sadly, I think just it may have been like before it was broadcast, but or like shortly after. But the actor who plays Donna's dad actually passed away very soon after this was filmed. So, yeah, sad for that. That's a bit of sad trivia. But yeah, Donna's mum and dad were there. Donna's mum was quite funny. It's sad to see the fact that she was one of the ones that was like going to have the reception without her.
Yeah.
Oh, it's cruel, you know, that your own mother would do that to you on your wedding day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Overall, though, I think, like having more of an arc for the Doctor, this episode, is something I've waited for a little bit. Something I waited for a little bit in season two. I think a lot of it was quite Rose centric.
I would say,
from what I remember.
Well, the Doctor stuff was very, some of it was Doctor-centric, but a lot of it wasn't, and like we said before, he was asleep for most of Christmas Invasion, and then he was possessed for New Earth, and then he was Scottish for Tooth and Claw. I mean, we did see a bit of, like, his deception and his, like, figure out the plot in that, and that was great, but again, it was like, it wasn't much depth to it. And the only, and then of course you get stuff like Rise of the Simon Age of Steel, which is Rose and Mickey focused. You've got Idiot's Lantern, which was just garbage. And you've got Love and Monsters, which was Doctor and Rose Light. Fear Her, which was, again, very surface level, but similar to Idiot's Lantern. And the only real episodes that actually...
Yeah, Satan's Pit.
The only ones that actually went into the Doctor deeply for me were School Reunion, Girl in the Fireplace, Impossible Planet Satan Pit, and the finale.
Yeah.
So you only got, like, half the series, and even then, it still wasn't as deep as Eccleston was.
Well, you still had another character in there as well, like obviously Impossible Planet and Satan's Pit. You still had like Rose throughout those episodes as well. I felt like this was definitely like you could feel the turmoil, like you said, that he was experiencing throughout this, and then you just bring along this whole hilarious cast to lift it up. It was good. It was a good contrast and a good way to progress it into a new series.
But again, like we said, there's a lot of reasons for the series 2 development being a little bit lessened, and one of them was Christopher Eccleston leaving at the last minute, and then having to cast a new Doctor and not having enough time to really let the script breathe. So yeah. We were kind of lucky to get what we got, to be honest.
That's true.
But what I like about it is that all of the events that we did get in Series 2 are now continuing. Like, those events are causing what we're getting now. So it's not like it's not like they're betraying the script. They're still rolling with what they did. If you get what I'm saying. So now it's like...
Yeah. They're not giving up on the... They're just overcoming the obstacles. Yeah, which is admirable.
And for me, what really carried Tennant in Series 2 was the actor. I thought the actor really brought more out of the character than was written in the script. Like he really established a lot of the personality and the surface level stuff. If you get what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
Which for me it was enough to enjoy. And then the few bits we did get were good. But I think it's great that now we get to getting into the second series with him, that they're finally digging into the character depth. And this is like kind of the cornerstone of when we finally get the fleshed out 10th Doctor, if you get what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It sort of all starts from Rose's exit
and
seeing him in this episode. So, yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah.
So, any other characters you wanted to talk about, or the plot, or should we move on to the next bit?
I think we should just move on. I think, I think it was definitely pretty character light. I mean, you got the robots, but man, they're just robots. Like, I don't really.
Oh yeah, there was only like four main characters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think we're good on characters. Yeah.
All right. So jump in the watch together that I've just sent you, and we will watch our classic clip. So for the people at home, we are going to be watching a classic clip called Leela Under Attack from the Talons of Wang Chiang.
Oh boy.
Said he'd seen a Chinaman outside the window.
And you jumped through it?
Something like that.
Stay here.
Man.
Leela! Leela, no! Don't!
Very noir-y.
Yes. Oh, I love this. The cinematography.
Very noir-y, dude.
The cinematography of that story is beautiful.
Yeah.
I love it.
That was cool. I like that.
Yeah. So I picked that one because obviously it's an action-heavy story, Runaway Bride, and as is Talons of Wang Chiang. So the funny thing about that scene, that story, it's the only story in which Tom Baker does not wear a scarf.
Right.
He did not wear a scarf for that story. So it's, that's an interesting thing. But yeah, what do you think of that?
That was cool. Yeah, I thought it was cool. I thought the it's definitely a different feel to what we watch. It's more of a more serious, sneaky.
Funnily enough, The Talons of Wang Chiang is one of the funniest stories.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's just, it's.
I guess that part.
That part of it was quite action heavy. I mean, it's a 6-part story, so there's a lot of like different phases it goes through, but there's definitely a lot of humor in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was cool though. Yeah, like I said, very noir-esque in the way it's shot. And the action sequences of her jumping out the window and stuff is very cool.
Yeah. For a bit of context, Leela is a savage.
Right.
She was
Haven't we watched a clip with her in it before?
Yeah, the one where the doctor explains which boxes are larger.
Yeah.
So she's basically a savage, and so she's very action heavy companion. She's quite a badass. Cool. Quite badass actually. She's quite fearless.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why she threw that like blunt knife at that thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. The one thing, though, unfortunately, about Talons of Wing Chiang that's a little bit awkward is the fact that the Chinese characters are played by British people wearing yellow face.
Mm, okay.
Which is, it's
a bit weird.
It's racist, but...
Yeah.
But, I mean, the reason why is because at that time in the 70s, there weren't a lot of Chinese actors in Britain.
Right.
Let alone, like, ones that could play the roles that they were casting.
Yeah.
And it's like, even though I don't condone it and think that it's okay, because obviously blackface and yellowface, it is racist. Mm. At the same time, the actor who plays Lee Sin Cheng is so good.
Right.
He doesn't do like a stereotype or anything, because you saw him in that with his, you know, the way he was acting in his dialogue. Like, he doesn't play a stereotype. Like, he's literally a nuanced character.
Yeah.
And I do.
I guess you. I mean, yeah.
I do think they were.
I didn't really take away that much for me. Like, it was. Obviously, it's a bit.
Yeah.
But
it's awkward. But I.
If you're not playing on tropes where you're like.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't want to get into the pedantics about it.
I know. It's awkward because at the end of the day, it is racism. But, yeah. At the very least, they tried to make it, like, really good. Because if you remove the yellow face from it, it's fucking brilliant. Like, like the character is one of the best villains in the show.
Yeah.
But it's just... Oh, man. It sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's best to let people decide for themselves what they think of it, because it's obviously a very sensitive thing.
Yeah. I mean, like I was saying, it didn't take anything away from me. I enjoyed the atmosphere of that clip.
Talons is beautiful. One of my favorite Tom Baker stories. The cinematography is brilliant. The script is great. The performance is everything. It was just, it's just a top notch story. And I chose the clip because obviously action heavy.
Yeah.
All right. So in terms of The Runaway Bride, the episode has a mixed reaction. A lot of it depends on your opinion on Catherine Tate as a comedian. Which
that would make a lot of sense.
Yes, which, as we know, comedy is very subjective. So, for example, Anthony, you know, our friend Anthony, he hates Catherine Tate's comedy. So naturally, he hated this episode.
Mm-hmm.
He just finds it unbearable, and I can see why someone would, because it's very loud. But it just, I think, for me, because of the way Donna's characterized, it fits for me. It's more than just a loud, you know, shouty woman that's getting married. Like, it's she's a person with characteristics, and this comes from a real place, and because it's believable, I feel like I can get invested in the comedy more.
Yeah,
if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Would you say the same?
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty open to when a comedian does acting and not typecasting them straight away, like Ricky Gervais, for example. I think he's definitely one of those people where if you've seen his comedy and you've seen things like The Office and you've seen things like Extras, that's another one that he's in, you will go into things with him in it thinking he's going to play that same, you know, he's sort of almost, I would argue, the same as Catherine Tate. He's a bit loud, he's a bit jovial, a bit over the top. But there's a lot of things with him in it that are very, very good if you don't go in there expecting him to, you know, you don't go in knowing what they are before.
Well, what I like, for example, about his character from The Office UK is that he's not just a joke machine. Like, he's an actual person.
Yeah. Have you seen Afterlife?
No, but I've heard all about it.
That's brilliant. I think that's the pinnacle of his acting career anyway.
Yeah.
But anyway, the point that I was getting to was, I know who Catherine Tate is, and I know her comedy, and I don't know it that well. It didn't really take anything away from, this was me watching a completely new character, a new actor. It didn't impact on me at all that she is a comedian.
Yeah, I mean, I think Anthony saw her in The Office US first, so that may have had a thing. But again, then again, he still wouldn't have enjoyed it regardless.
Yeah.
And I understand, like, comedy is very subjective. Very subjective.
Yeah.
Something that a lot of people praised about the episode is that it didn't forget Rose. It felt like a connective tissue. And then one thing that was criticized about the production was that it's meant to be a Christmas special, but it was filmed in the summer, and it's very obvious that it was filmed in the summer.
Yeah. which we wouldn't notice because we're used to
Christmas being in the summer.
So I didn't even fucking bat an eye at that. But now that I think about it, like when he made it snow, at the end there, it was like, well, that's surely not that out of the ordinary.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't inherently think about that.
Yeah. It's a little nitpick, I suppose.
Yes, definitely nitpick.
Yeah. So obviously it was written by the showrunner, Russell T. Davies.
Mm-hmm.
He had the idea for this episode from the very beginning of his association with the program, and he planned to air it in series 2. But with the public announcement of the 2 Christmas specials, and the private knowledge of Billy Piper leaving at the end, Davies decided to elevate this story to the Christmas special, not introducing the new companion immediately and filling the slot with Tooth and Claw.
Right.
So both Tooth and Claw and Love and Monsters were filled in. They weren't meant to be there.
Right.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
I thought his writing was really good. I thought it was really solid. And it was an episode for him in terms of his writing that had a lot of connective tissue, because not only was it referencing stuff from like the finale, but also from the Doctor's past with Gallifrey, but then also there was references to Torchwood in there as well.
Yeah.
You can really start to feel that he's starting to really build a world with this, like, show, you know?
100%. That's what I was going to say, is like what this felt like was more and more of the development of the universe that we're watching.
Mm.
So with the different, so many, there's many different arcs going on now, and that's really what's making.
Yeah.
I think the key to a show being interesting and successful is, like, you need that overarching theme that you're trying to figure out.
Mm.
Like, you get clues to it every now and again, like, it's dotted in, but a good writer really knows how little or how much they need to put into
his
writing, and I think he really nailed it on this one with the connectiveness to the overarching story of what is Torchwood at the moment, and also the wrapping up of the story that we had just finished.
And also, I think, because as we're recording this, we're also going to be doing one for the first episode of Torchwood as well. So this kind of like builds up a bit of anticipation for what's going to be going on there, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I kind of planned it out that way.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I think Russell T. Davies does a great job of paying attention to detail.
Yeah, I agree.
Yes. So the director was Yuris Lynn. He did The End of the World, The Unquiet Dead, Tooth and Claw, Girl in the Fireplace, Idiot's Lantern, and Fear Her. Very mixed amongst those, I would say. The Idiot's Lantern was probably the worst direction we've had because of all the Dutch angles. Yeah. But then stuff like Tooth and Claw and The Girl in the Fireplace looked amazing. What I would say is, I think the framing of the shots was really good in this, and like I liked all the cuts and stuff. But
it was simple.
But
it was simply done. It was good.
And I thought a lot of the space CGI was great, especially with the stuff back like billions of years in the past. The only thing I have with the direction is probably partially to do with the fact that it was filmed in summer. Is I feel like the color grading was a bit bland in this.
Yeah.
With the outside shots. The outside shots were too sunny and too bland.
Yeah. And I'm obviously, we're watching it on different monitors, so and my monitor kind of saturates things a little bit.
Mm.
So it looked fine to me. Okay. But I think definitely like they took a more simplistic route, definitely with editing and cinematography, and the sound was really good. I mean, we're gonna get into music soon, but there was definitely some wacky angles here and there, but they weren't just over the top.
I think that,
and fucking in your face.
I think the best directed scene was the climax when the Doctor's drowning the spiders.
Yeah, and there's all the fire and the angles and stuff, and like, he's silhouetted.
I love that shot where she tells him to stop and you just see his mouth open and he like starts to realize what he's doing.
Yeah.
Because like, imagine what would have happened to him had she not been there. Like, what would have happened? Yeah. Like, he may have even drowned in there.
Yeah, true.
If he didn't break out of his trance. But yeah, I thought the direction in that was great. I was going to say something else, but I can't remember. The underground stuff looked great. It was mainly just the outside stuff that was a little bit... I just thought it was a bit pedestrian.
Mm.
But that was uplifted by the performances. Oh, and actually, I will say the sequence where they had the TARDIS chase the car, that was well directed as an action scene.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm in my wedding dress! Yes, you look lovely! Well, seeing as you mentioned it, how about we get into the music? What did you think of the music?
Well, it was blaring my ears, most of it. which I'm not complaining about, because it was really good. It was, if the audio was normal for me, and I was,
if it was mixed,
mainly focusing
mixed
on the dialogue, I don't think I would have noticed it as much as I did. But I definitely thought at some points, like, this is really revving up, and, you know, like, it's getting very intense and orchestral, and it was really good. I just thought it carried the episode, and there wasn't any, it didn't take a hold too much.
Yeah, it was very action heavy.
Yeah. What was that song? There was that song that, like, it broke out into an actual produced song during the
reception. Yeah, I can't remember what
and
it was.
I like how that contrasted with the Doctor having flashbacks. Like, that was it's a very classic way of invoking emotion by having that contrast between watching everyone be happy and listen to happy music and then
also
someone reminiscing on something that is very sad.
Yeah, and also it's funny because this scene probably would have played out a bit differently had Eccleston been in this episode, for example, because that scene was meant to be reflective of them dancing. But because if they use clips from the Doctor dances, it might be a bit jarring because it's not Tennant. So what they had to do is they had to use the scene from New Earth when he's picking her up and it looks like dancing.
Yeah. it still worked, though.
It still... Oh, yeah.
Which is good.
It worked, yeah.
Fucking... Do you reckon they couldn't use the Crystal Wilkinson stuff because he was not allowed on BBC stuff as well?
No.
At that point?
No, it's not about that. They have rights to the archive footage. It's just that...
Right.
Narratively, it would have been a bit strange to not have Tennant in the flashback, if that makes sense.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
Well, to new viewers and everything as well, it would have not made sense.
It would be like, yeah, I don't know. It's a weird one.
Yeah.
It still worked. So, shall we get on to the track of the episode?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, go on to Spotify and look up Donna's theme. Go.
Got a bit of a rhythm to it, doesn't it? How many plays has it got? 342,000. so many different phrases from just different instruments going on all over the shop.
So how was that? Donna's theme.
That was good. Yeah, that was fun. It started off slow and then built itself up. I can't remember what scene that would have been playing in. I assume the car chase.
Anytime there's comedy. Basically. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Would you say it's... Oh, and also the flashback to when her and Lance met.
Right.
Yeah. Would you say it fits Donna's character?
Yeah, I'd say so.
It's very different to Rose's theme, isn't it? Very different.
Yeah, very different.
Yeah. Like, Rose's theme was quite... it was quite deadpan. It was, like, very light and piano-y, but it was quite deadpan and like, had a real sort of emotion to it. Whereas this is more like a fun theme, if you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's cool. It's very catchy. Yeah, but Murray Gold, what a bloody genius again, or as always.
Yeah. He's just getting better and better.
Mm. Oh, yes, I remember what I was going to say now, but the direction. There's a really weird bit of trivia about this episode. So you know how the very start, the pre-title sequence, when she's in the TARDIS... So the one that they had in the episode was a reshoot,
right?
Compared to the one that happened at the end of Doomsday, and you can tell because the lighting is completely different.
Yeah.
Because at the end of Doomsday, it's like green and dark, and then in this one, it was light, and they've completely redone the TARDIS.
It would have just been a pickup that they thought would have ended the episode well back when they were editing. Series 2,
well,
I would assume.
If you remember all the TARDIS scenes from series 1 and 2, they had a green glow to them.
Yeah.
Whereas now it's all like bright and not like that at all.
Yeah.
Like they've completely redone all the lighting and they had to reshoot that scene. It's crazy.
Mm.
It's also like almost a plot hole because the same thing happens with different lighting.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. It's really weird. But the great thing about it is the actors pretty much did exactly what they did again.
Yeah. Yeah.
Almost to the T. Also, the other thing was they redid the Doctor Who logo in the title sequence.
Yeah.
You
mentioned that.
The fire logo is actually what it was always meant to be, but they never finished it when they were doing series 1 and they just They left that like template bronze one.
Yeah.
So, yeah. It's a bit weird, isn't it?
Yeah. It's minor things, though. Minor things.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, but the $10 notes that feature the Doctor's face on them that came out of the machine, they say, I promise to pay the bearer on demand of the sum of 10 satsumas, which is a reference to the Christmas invasion.
Yeah.
Yeah. In a lot of ways, this felt like a bit of a sequel to that story, because you had the Santas again.
Yeah. In a way, yeah. Because they referenced it throughout the episode as well.
Yeah, how he was talking about the family and how they're gone.
Yeah.
Apparently, Catherine Tate was so busy she couldn't even be there for the read-through.
Really?
So the person that played the read-through was Sophia Miles, who played Madame de Pompadour in The Girl in the Fireplace. And it would be because David Tennant and Sophia Miles were dating at the time. So he would have been like, hey, you want to come do this?
Yep, makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, apparently originally the Doctor throws after like Donna picks up Rose's like jacket thing, it was garment. Apparently originally he was meant to open the TARDIS doors and throw it into space, but apparently it was cut because it was too melodramatic.
Right.
So the Webstar was shot down by a tank. On the orders of Mr. Saxon.
Mr. Saxon? Why is that important? I can't remember.
Well, the only other time you've heard about Mr. Saxon, well, not necessarily heard, but I've talked about it, I didn't actually say, but the newspaper that the Absorbaloff was reading in Love and Monsters had Mr. Saxon written on it.
Ah.
So, just keep that in mind.
Okay.
Someone named Mr. Saxon ordered the tank.
Mr. Saxon
ordered the tank to shoot down the Webstar.
Okay. Sounds like some Torchwood stuff.
You'll have to wait and see.
Maybe.
Because if you remember last Christmas, it was Torchwood that shot up the Sycorax ship.
Mm-hmm.
And this time, Mr. Saxon shot up the Webstar.
Yeah.
A controversy occurred during the filming as guests at a hotel were awakened by frightened by gunfire and explosions during filming of one scene. including one who had just returned from the conflict in Israel.
Oh, come on, producers. You gotta be on top of that one.
Oh, jeez.
That's just a damn lawsuit waiting to happen.
Joe, those said at Christmas, it was filmed in late July and it was 30 degrees centigrade. David Tennant quoted saying he was blinking boiling during filming.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I feel bad for them. Right now, it's mid-August. And what are we looking at? It's like a nice 11 degrees.
That's winter for us, though.
Nice winter.
This was the first episode of New Who to have a completely different cast from the first episode of Series 1. So none of the actors that were in this episode appeared in Rose.
Interesting. That's cool.
Yeah. That's probably why it feels so different. Because it's completely... Yeah,
it didn't really feel that different to me.
Character-wise, though, it's all the different... A completely different cast to what we originally had.
Yeah.
Which is, that sort of shows how the show can evolve, really.
Hmm.
Apparently, between takes where you can't see the bottom of her legs, Catherine Tate wore sports shoes instead of high heels.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
That's good call.
Oh, yeah, there was the tribophysical waveform macrokinetic extrapolator. That was in Boomtown and Parting of the Ways. That was brought it back again.
Yep.
So again, like connective tissue. I love when Russell T does that.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. The Doctor's pockets being bigger on the inside also happened with the Fourth Doctor. He had a story where someone, this character asked him to turn out his pockets and he had to like take all this stuff out of his pockets. It's really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah, the ending was weird how like the TARDIS dematerialized and then took off vertically into the sky. This has happened before in a story called Fury from the Deep from the 60s.
All right.
Which will be coming out on DVD as an animation soon because it's a missing story. Apparently it took 4 hours to transform Sarah Parrish into the Empress of the Rachnos.
Wow. That's not too bad, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean...
Considering some other prosthetics.
Yeah, you hear about Jim Carrey, it took 8 hours to do The Grinch.
Yeah.
So he had to wake up at like 3 a.m.
Yeah.
And then do a 12-hour shoot.
That's horrible.
That's just torture.
You just fall asleep whilst they're putting you into the suit.
The climax originally was going to take place at Stonehenge, but Russell T. Davies was not able to come up with a satisfactory rationale for its involvement, so it was abandoned. However, what I can say is, Stonehenge does appear again in Doctor Who.
Okay.
Viewership, 9.3 million.
That's which, pretty good.
Really good, but less than the Christmas Invasion. Christmas Invasion was over 10.
Yep.
But it was still... 9.3
solid still.
Still a fantastic rating. So, give your conclusion and a rating out of 10 for The Runaway Bride.
I think it was a very well written, very well directed, just clean story that made a lot of sense to the series, that made a lot of sense to the characters, and it wasn't outlandish in the way that the motives of the villain wasn't ridiculous, and the reason why they're there and the connection to the Doctor and everything wasn't too hard to believe as well, and it all just seemed like it was a well thought out episode that they didn't restrict themselves on, but they definitely would have thought about like making sure things made sense to what they were doing. So for that, in respect of that, like I think this is a solid episode, and I really enjoyed it, so I'll give it a 8 out of 10, I think.
Cool. Yeah, The Runaway Bride's great. It's not the best episode of all time. It's not particularly complex, but I really like what it does do. The plot's solid. It's really fun. It's action-packed. Definitely some money spent. Performances were really good, with Arachnos getting the right kind of ham, and then with Catherine Tate and David Tennant's great chemistry. And also, I love the way that this episode dug deep into the depth of the Doctor's character, which was my biggest takeaway from it. It was a fantastic follow-up to Doomsday. And just overall, just a really fun episode. And, you know, it's exactly the kind of thing you'd want for a Christmas special, I think. It was just great fun. So, like you, I'm also going to give it an 8 out of 10. Really solid.
Mm-hmm.
Well done, Russell T. Nice. So, with that said, that means that obviously today we're going to be doing our first episode of Torchwood, but in terms of Doctor Who, next time we'll be starting Series 3.
Okay.
With Episode 1, which is called Smith and Jones.
Oh.
So what are you anticipating for Smith and Jones?
Is it, we going to the Wild West?
I mean, why would you? Is the Smith and Jones a Wild West reference?
No, I just makes me think of Smith and Weston.
No, okay.
Don't know. Maybe we are going to the Wild West. That would be kind of interesting.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah. You intrigued to see?
I am intrigued to see. I don't really know what I'm in store for, but I'm sure I'll enjoy it.
All right. Hopefully. Well, in that case, we will see you all next time for Smith and Jones.
Peace. Be safe. Wash your hands.
Wear your mask.